Good morning. Let's say that again. Good morning. All right. I want to ask you to open your Bible to Psalm chapter 11 on this 11th day of September, Psalm 11. And when we look at Psalm 11, you know, if we read through it, we recognize that this psalm is written during a time of real threat. Terror is in the air. Enemies lurk in the shadows of this psalm. And it's what David tells us in this psalm that really stands out for us. It really provides stability for us in the midst of panic. And we all remember that day, you know, that where we were on that day, and remember how we felt. You know, one of the things that stands out for me is I walked away from that day with a deep respect for those first responders, for our firefighters and police and EMT and military, those that put their life on the line. I'm just going to ask as we go ahead and get into this, if you're a part of one of those first responders or one of those that help keep our nation safe, would you stand? Let's recognize you today. Police, EMT, fire, anyone here that did? Thank you very much. We honor you. Thank you. Now, we remember that day a few days afterwards, September 14th, the nation watched a televised service. The president of our nation asked Billy Graham to speak to the nation, to bring a word of God to the nation. And so he did from the National Cathedral. And you can go and you can read all of what he said. I just had some things that I wanted to highlight that stood out. He said to us on that day, "We come together today to affirm our conviction that God cares for us. Though no matter how hard we try, words simply cannot express the horror, the shock, the revulsion we all feel over what took place in this nation on Tuesday morning, September 11th. That day will go down in our history as a day to remember. But today we come together in this service to confess our need of God. We've always needed God from the very beginning of this nation, but today we need Him especially. We need the help of the Spirit of the living God." So what Billy Graham was doing on that day was he was turning our attention heavenward. He was focusing us on to God and His ability. The threat is real. The terror is real. It has always been out there. But it reminded us of who God is and what God can do. And we needed that word that day. Well, here we are 15 years later, and we still need that word from the Lord. And that's what is being shared with us in this 11th psalm. The psalm speaks to a time when it seemed as though the world was about to stop spinning. They were about to face a major difficulty in the life of the nation and for King David. There was some enemy. We're not sure who in this psalm, but there is some enemy that is threatening. And the context is ripe for panic. I mean, the whole context seems to be surrounded with this threat that would call for panic. But I want us to notice what David says to us, and I want us to notice what David did that provides stability in the face of panic. Notice verse 1. The first thing that stands out is that David tells us we're to sing, run straight to the arms of God. That's verse 1. And as he makes his declaration of confidence, this is his declaration of confidence. In the Lord, I take refuge. Let's say that together. In the Lord, I take refuge. Refuge. And what we need to hear is that this is his first course of action. that this is his life default. This is what he does. This is the normal response of his life. His first course of action is to turn to the Lord. This is the core of his life, to have an absolute trust in God. You know, the word refuge is found 40 times in the Bible, over 40 times in the Bible. And the Lord, for David, is his hiding place. His hiding place in the Lord is the Lord. This is his stronghold. The Lord is his stronghold. The Lord is his security. The Lord is his surety and his confidence and his trust. He's absolutely sure in who the Lord is. And so when this threat is arising, what he says is the first thing that he does, his first order of business, is to run straight into the arms of the Lord. Oh, if we could just remember that. And when you look at verse 1, it's as though David is offended. He's offended by the words of his advisors. David, I got a fly on me. It's the devil bothering me up here. Sorry. It's as though David... That's what we're going to do to our enemies. It's as though David is offended by his advisors. You know, David's the king of the nation. He's surrounded by people that's giving a different kind of advice. And notice it says, how? Almost as if, how dare you say to my soul, to the very core of my life, flee like a bird to your mountain? You know, that would have been a popular, a well-known expression of the day. Kind of like if we said, get the heck out of Dodge, man. Get out of here. We said, get out of Dodge. We'd understand that. That's a cliche that we'd use. Man, you got to get out of here. And that's what they were saying to David. And he's offended by that. How dare you say to my soul, to the core of my life, flee like a bird. Get out of here. You know, the truth is that people do the strangest things in a moment of panic. And sometimes they can give the strangest advice in a moment of panic. And we can hear the advisors saying to David, David, you need to be more realistic. David, you need to be more practical. You're talking about trusting God, but it's time to run, brother. It's time to run. It's time to get out of here. It's time to get to somewhere else. It's time to get to that mountain up there, find some shelter. And they say, flee. And this word in Hebrew, it's a word that's similar to the fluttering of wings. Flee like a bird, like a fluttering of wings. Flee. It's almost like the shaking of wings, be shaken. It's almost like the going back and forth of a bird. You know, when I was a kid, I grew up in the forested area in Alabama. And one of the things I loved to do was to go quail hunting. If anybody is going on a quail hunt, I'd love to preach or go. I'd love to go with you. But I'd go quail hunting. I had a bird dog. And we'd go out there and I had this little short barrel, double barrel shotgun. 20 gauge, and go out there, and that dog would go on point. Now, the whole thing is to spook those birds, to get them it panicked, and they would flutter, and you spook a covey of quail, and they just explode, and they fly all directions in a moment of panic. It's what they do. It's a survival mode. Get out, go, and all directions. And that was the advice. And we get some strange advice, and sometimes even as believers, we give each other strange advice. They're advising David, David, you need to cave in to your panic. They were saying to David, you should take off like a bird. You should accelerate out of the situation. Get out of here just as fast as you possibly can. Run. It's the only reasonable course of action is to get out and go. But David responds, how can you say to my soul? How can you speak to this part of me that makes me whole inside, makes me who I am, that I should flee to some other shelter, flee to some mountain where I can find safety. David's first course of action is to place his first full trust in the Lord. Isn't that good advice? Isn't that what he's saying to us? Put our absolute trust. And then verse 2, you can see here, it's almost like his advisors are describing the real threat. And what we know is that the threat is real around us, that we are facing things that terrify us. And it's almost like they're describing the threat. They say, behold, the enemy, whatever that enemy is, the enemy, the wicked, the unrighteous, those who are everything that the righteous are not, those who do not have the wholeness of God, the wholeness of being inside them, those who do not genuinely have a connection to God. The advisor said, look, they're treading on the bow. Many of you are bow hunters. You know what that looks like. And you put your foot on the bow, and they're stringing the bow. They're bringing it back. They're putting the string on the bow. They're locking the arrow. They're preparing to attack. And it just seems like they're right there, preparing to shoot arrows from the shadows, from the darkness. And they're going to shoot at those that are right, that are straight, that are upright with God. And that may be what the advisors are saying. But you know what's interesting? When I read through this, no arrow has been shot. Nothing has really actually happened yet. There's just a threat. There's just a threat. And in the context of the threat, there's a panic that is rising up. And they wanted to give in to that panic. And they say, flee. Look at the threatening situation and flee. Give in. Run. But David knew something that all of us know. David knew that if he fled, if that was his first course of action, some things would have welled up inside him. One, it would have created a feeling of abandonment. It would have been as though, if that was his first course of action, it would have been as though he was turning his back on God. And then he's the head of the nation. And if he fled for his life, what would that be saying to the others if he left them behind? He'd lose some significance as a leader in the eyes of the people. And then if he did flee to his mountain, how would he feel? He'd just be left with feelings of despair. Where do you go? And that seems to be what the question is being posed in verse 3. Verse 3 says, when the foundations are being destroyed, what can the righteous do then? If the foundations are being turned upside down, and we're not talking about a rock-solid foundation, we're talking about the kind of foundation where it seems as though evil has the upper hand. It seems as though evil is calling itself righteous and righteous, and that context is coming against someone who is standing seeking the Lord and to be right with the Lord, and yet it seems as though they're going to prevail. What is someone to do when it seems as though the world is turned upside down and it seems as though they're having the upper hand? Well, David answers that. And that answers that classic question. In the Lord, I take refuge. There it is. That's the wisdom of my confidence. In the Lord, I take refuge. Listen, we are facing things. We're facing things that are coming against us as a nation, things that come against us as a church. We're facing things as individuals where it's being pressing in every side. There are those voices out there that are saying, there's no hope for you. It is over. David had a different word for us. He says, the very first place I go is to the Lord. And then he shares with us the second thing is that the confidence for his wisdom. When he says, no, I'm not going to panic. I'm going to go to the Lord. I'm going to let the fear be my counselor. I'm going to let him be my counselor. He will guide my every step. Here is confidence for his wisdom that he is saying to us and singing for us today. And that is not only run, but second, rest in the sovereignty of God. Rest in the sovereignty. You see that word sovereignty? That means that God is in control. You believe that? That means that God has full authority over everything that comes into my life and around my life. I am His, and I belong to Him. He's saying that He is sovereign God. He has full authority not only over my life, but over all that is going on around me. And what does David say? Look, where is God? Verse 4. The Lord is in His holy temple. The Lord is in heaven. He is reigning over all of this. He is full authority over it, over all things. And David recognized God's sovereignty as the foundation for his life. That's his confidence. Is there anything that God can't handle? Is there anything too big for God? Is there anything that He can't move out of the way? No. God is sovereign. Is there any enemy that He can't conquer? No. David says, this is the source of the confidence for my wisdom. The confidence of my wisdom is knowing where God is, who God is. Right? And in contrast, David is where? He's in the Lord. He's in the refuge of the Lord. The Lord is his place of strength and help and comfort. The Lord is the authority over his life. But not so for the wicked, the unrighteous, the enemy of his soul. It says, while he is in the light of the Lord, they're hiding in the shadows. You know what's interesting when I look at these few verses of Scripture? It's almost as though they're in the shadows, but they are assuming themselves to be in a position of strength. And that's the way the enemies are. They go, I got you. I got you. I'm going to take you down. And they're breathing their threats. And even David's advisors assume that God is not really the kind of God that can provide any real tangible help in time of need. They say, run. He said, no, I'm going to the Lord. And I want you to see what David says. David says, God is in his heavenly temple. On the seat of authority, that's where he is. And that's my foundation. And the place where I take refuge is with him. Amen? It's with Him. I take refuge with Him. That's where I am. Up there. Higher. Brought above it. That's where my refuge is. He is a higher refuge than you can imagine. He's a far greater place to be than any other place. He offers greater stability than any mountain could provide. He is greater provision of safety than any massive army around me. That's who he is. And David knew that. David had taken out a lion and a bear. He had taken down a giant named Goliath. He had placed his full trust in God. Good heavens! He had seen God at work. He knows what he can do. So why would I flee, David seems to say, to anywhere else but to God, who is holy and is set apart. He is seated in a position of authority. He is sovereign. He is in control. That's what I'm going to choose. And that's what the righteous, people whose wholeness of life is found deep in the heart of God. That's the natural response of God's people turn to the Lord. And verse 4 tells us that his eyes behold, his eyes see, his eyes see. His eyes are always seeing. It's kind of an interesting word in Hebrew. It's a word meaning he can see through his eyelids. You know, we have eyelids that he can see. You know, it's kind of like a mom at home with eyes in the back of her head. You know, God can see. And he can see both the righteous and the unrighteous. He can see the person whose wholeness is found in him and the person who has rejected him. He can see. And what David says is that he tests the righteous. And David may be saying something like, God may be testing the metal of my life in him. So things do come to our lives. Things do come against us. Enemies speak threats from the shadows. And there are things that come against us, and we can often see them. That's true. But David says, I'm not afraid of that. It's just God testing me. It's God putting me through the refiner's fire. It's God purifying my life. Put me under some intense heat to reveal the real inner quality of who I am. And in some ways, though it's not quite said here, it is as though he is thanking God, praising God for the intensity of the moment so that he can be driven deeper into his walk with the Lord. And he's also not only examining the righteous, but he's also examining the wicked, the enemy, the unrighteous, that real threat. And it comes down to this, the illuminating gaze of God, who is able to distinguish between what is good and what is evil, between what is right and what is wrong. And David says, I'm trusting the Lord in this matter. And then you see here that he speaks specifically to the ones who love violence. The Lord examines the righteous, but the wicked, those who love violence. You know the Hebrew word for violence is? It's the word Hamas. The Hebrew word for violence is Hamas. And it is a word that means to breathe, live, desire, to attack and destroy. And it says that God examines those whose very heartbeat is to breathe violence, to attack and destroy. And it says that God stands opposed. It's a very strong word. He hates with a passion those whose very heart is violence. And it's not, God loves everyone. What it's saying is that God stands opposed to that kind of action, attitude. And it's, and they may be thinking, we got this. We're going to drink from the cup of victory. We're going to have victory over David. But instead it says that God is going to rain down traps from heaven. Sort of this interesting play on words, because they were saying flee like a bird, and God says he's going to drop a trap down on those who want to destroy. They expect to drink in satisfaction. We've done it. We got it. We're going to win. But God's going to pour down traps, maybe fire, brimstone, burning wind, and that's the portion that they will drink. Our refuge is knowing that the choice we're making, our refuge is to choose the Lord, to trust him, to be vulnerable before him. To trust God is not an unrealistic action. Trusting God may be the most realistic action we can make. It certainly is the very best thing we can do. Amen? So he can destroy. He can distinguish. He can see what's going on. So first, you know, we run directly. When the threat comes, we run right into the arms of God. Then we can rest in his sovereignty. He's in control. He knows what he's doing. He's got us. Sometimes we feel like, man, it's all falling apart. God's got us. He's got us. And nobody knew that more than Jesus and his example in the Garden of Gethsemane. Where in the cover of darkness all around, the enemy breathing on him, the soldiers coming to get him, Jesus praying for the fulfillment of God's purpose. And he says, not my will, but yours. You know what that is? That's absolute trust. Jesus faced the cross, buried in the tomb, raised victorious. God has a final word. Here's the other thing. That is, we can rely on God's justice. You know, we know that there's much of this world that is unfair. But what we hear in this, in verse 7, is that God has the final say, and we can rely, we can trust his act of justice. What that means is he's going to make things right. One day he's going to set things right. So said, "Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord." One day he's going to make things right. He loves righteousness. He loves wholeness. And David is saying that running to him as a refuge is to be made whole in his presence. Become like him. Become righteous. You see this verse? Let me just read it. And I want you to focus in on the last three words. For the Lord is righteous. He loves justice. And the upright will see his face. Now, I thought about what a rescuer does. A fireman that goes into a burning building. A policeman that goes into a hostage situation to recover someone. And if you could just picture with me in either instance where that rescuer comes out with that person in their arms and their face is turned and they're looking face to face. And I think that's what David is saying. He doesn't know how it's all going to shake out, but he knows his first order of business is go to the Lord. He knows that he can completely rest in him, and he knows that he can rely on God to work everything out in a way. When it's all said and done, God did that. Imagine the intimacy. If we could just run to him, he will scoop us up and hold us in his arms. He will bring us in a context where it's face to face. I don't know about you, but I think that there's no safer place in all the world than in the arms of God.